The French Chef is made possible by a grant from the Polaroid Corporation and a grant from Hills Brothers Coffee Incorporated.
This is a tambour parmentier surrounded by a ragout à l'improviste. In other words, instant mashed potatoes and yesterday's pot roast. We're doing improvisation today on The French Chef. Welcome to The French Chef. I'm Julia Child. You know, I just love to muck around in the kitchen. I like to make up things and just experiment around. In fact, I just love to improvise. As a matter of fact, I'm going to improvise today because I've got this big old bunch of meat here. This is yesterday's roast, and I've cut it up into nice chunks, and I'm going to make a stew out of it. But I also want something else to improvise with, so I'm going to use some instant mashed potatoes. These are great fun to play around with, and I've been doing some experiments, and I'm going to turn them into a mold of mashed potatoes called a tambour parmentier. Parmentier presumably was the inventor of the potato or brought it to Europe, so anything that has potatoes in it is called very often parmentier. And what these instant mashed potatoes are, they're dehydrated, which means that all the water has been taken out of, and then I suppose they've been cooked first and then dehydrated, and what you have to do is to put the water back in again, and you want to follow what the directions say on the package. There's several different kinds of brands, and in this particular one you have to be sure to take the butter off your glasses so you can read what it says. And this one says that this package serves 8. And I'm going to make a mold for about 6 people, so I'm going to use a package and a half. And it says for a package and a half we need 3 3/4 cup of boiling water. So I've got some water, 3 3/4 of cup of water here. And then according to the directions for 12 servings, I want 6 tablespoons of butter, or 3/4 of a stick, and then 1 1/2 tablespoons of salt. And then when the water's come to a boil, the potatoes go in. Maybe I better measure that salt out so I'll be really following the package directions. So instead of putting it in my hand, I'll put it actually into these little measuring spoons, which I really hate to do, but I think when you're following a package, it's a very good idea to do just what they say. Then those have to come to the, that water has to come to the boil, and then it says that for half a package is 1 1/4 cups, so I'll measure 1 1/4 cups out in here, so I'll be all ready when the water boils. There's 1 1/4, and that's all ready. Now we just have to wait for the water. It also says to beat them up with a fork, but I found that beating them up with a wire whip really beats them up better, because it says that the more you beat them, the better the potatoes will be. Now that's almost at the boil. But I think whenever you run into these new products, it's fun to give them a good try out, because you never know, you may run into something that'll be extremely good. So there, the water's at the boil, so here goes in half a package, and here goes in the other package. I presume you have to do this with all possible speed, and then beat them all up. And with this, I'm also on the package, it says after you've rehydrated them like this, that you can beat in more, usually adds liquid or some other liquid like milk. But I want these just rehydrated, and then I'm going to add my own liquid. And I'm going to put a wet pot holder here just to hold the pan. And then I'm going to These are going to be molded, so I want them to have a more flavor and have a slight puff when they go into the oven. So I'm going to beat in 3 egg yolks. And I can always freeze the whites and use them for making souffles. Just put in 1, and now it's getting too thick to use my whip, so I'll take a wooden spoon. And these, the egg yolks give them a little more sort of interest and quality. I couldn't explain just what it is, but it seems to help them, and it also gives them a little bit of a puff, too. And there goes the 3rd ones going in. This is really the way you make those pomme de chasse, you know, those that border of Duchess potatoes. You always start out with your egg yolks like this. You could use it in a border too, but I found that it's nicer baked in a dish. It seems to be a little lighter. Now I want to have some cheese in. I'm going to put in about 1/2 cup, about 3/4 cup of grated Swiss cheese. It's another thing, if you grate your Swiss cheese yourself, you can freeze it, and it keeps very nicely, because I think freshly grated cheese is always much better than the kind that you buy in a store, already grated, because it's fresher. And then we'll have to have some pepper and some nutmeg. This is a little nutmeg grater that holds the nutmeg. I want just a big pinch, not too much, because when you use nutmeg, you never want to know that it's in. It just gives a little flavor to it. And about 1/8 teaspoon of pepper. And then this can now have some cream in. Rather than adding milk, about 1/2 cup of heavy cream is very nice indeed. And I think it's easier to add it bit by bit. If you were on a diet and couldn't use heavy cream, you could use milk. It always seems too bad to use milk when you can use cream, because it does give a much nicer body to things. And with this, you don't want it to be as loose as it would be for ordinary mashed potatoes. Now that's a little cream going all over. And then you want to be sure and taste it, and be sure that you have just as much flavoring in as you want. Very good. Be sure that there's plenty of salt and everything else in it. And then these are all ready to go into a mold and bake. And with this, you can use any kind of a straight-sided baking dish that you want. You could use one like this, which is just plain straight-sided 6-cup or a fireproof glass one. I'm going to use my dear old Charlotte, which is a 6-cup one and has straight sides, just because it reminds me of La Belle France. That's why I always like to use it. Now you want to butter the mold very heavily. Take softened butter and just smear it all around in the bottom of the dish and on the sides. This, when you're going to bake something and unmold it in the oven, be sure that you heavily butter things, otherwise you find that it's not going to unmold. And then again, as a bit of safety for unmolding, I'm going to put some wax paper in the bottom of the dish. And for that, set your dish right on top of the wax paper and take a little knife and cut all around to make a mark. Then just take some scissors and cut it out. Usually you'll find that the knife hasn't really cut through the paper. These are some great big scissors I got in France the last time we were there, supposedly for cutting off fish scales. I think they're nice for almost anything. And then put the paper in the bottom of the mold. And then again, so that things are not going to stick, you want to roll some breadcrumbs around in it. So take about 3 or 4 tablespoons of breadcrumbs. This, again, is something I always have on hand, or breadcrumbs, which I've let get stale and then ground up in the blender and frozen. And then roll these crumbs all around in the side of the dish. And then you want to knock out the extra crumbs. You want to be sure that it's on the side, and I forgot to put some butter in the bottom, which was silly, so I'll have to put it in on top of the crumbs. But if you don't have the bottom buttered, the crumbs will stick on to the paper will stick onto the top of the potatoes. Let's see, I'm rolling this all around, and I'm over at the sink so that I can dump out all the extra crumbs. There. So now that's all lined, and I see that there isn't very much in the bottom, so I'm going to put a little bit more on the bottom. Be sure that's fully crumbed, and then the potatoes will come out very easily. And then in go the potatoes. Now, I found if you want to do this ahead of time, it's supposed to rise up when it goes into the oven. And if you've packed this in and then, say, put it in the refrigerator, it doesn't rise as well as if it's nice and hot when you put it in. So if you want to do it ahead, you can do all of the mixture and then beat it up before you put it into the mold, and then you'll be sure that it will rise. But I actually think it's so quick to do that you don't need to do anything ahead. Now, with these, you can, with this exactly the same mixture, you could do, say, if you're going to do a shepherd's pie, you know, that sort of a meat stew with potatoes on top, you could use this same mixture on top of the baking dish and then put it in the oven. Or you could use it in just a plain low-sided baking dish, and it will puff up nicely and serve it in the dish. But this is much more dramatic. And this now goes into a 375-degree oven in the middle level and should bake just about an hour until it puffs up nicely and browns. And then it's all ready. And then while that's doing, we will get at this old yesterday's roast. I mean, I can't say it's old because it is yesterday's. So it's nice, fresh. And this happens to be roast lamb. And I've just cut it off into some big chunks. I think I've cut almost all of it off, so there's one chunk there. And I'm going to turn it into a stew because I think cold meat is rather dull. And along with the stew, you have to have some flavor. And I here have a group of flavor ingredients, which I've collected from my shelves and the refrigerator and everywhere else. And when you're doing an improvisation like this, you've done an awful lot of stews anyway, and so just follow the general principle. You usually always want onions in it, and if you have any fresh green peppers, you can use those. So I have here about 2 cups of onions and 1 cup of chopped green peppers, and I'm going to sauté them in oil until they're very lightly brown. Need just enough cooking oil or olive oil, which I always use, just to film the bottom of the pan. And in they go. Got my wooden spatula back again. And then these should cook and lightly brown for about, say 5 or 10 minutes. And this is the casserole I'm going to cook the stew in. And after they've started cooking, put the cover on and then let them cook slowly. In about 5 and 10 minutes, they'll be very lightly brown and soft. And then they'll give off their flavor, and the brown will help to brown the sauce. And then while those are doing, you want to brown the meat, and that you will do in a separate pan. And I'm going to use my faithful giant no stick'em, which I like very much. And again, this is going to be just filmed with cooking oil. And then I'm going to brown the meat because that's going to give it more flavor. I've got about, 3.5 to 4 cups of meat here. And this will be enough for, 4 to 6 people. It just depends on, how much meat. You never know how much meat you're going to have in the leftover. And with this, it will take about 2 or 3 minutes to brown. And be sure to do use this method of shaking your pan back and forth rather than turning the meat. It's much quicker and easier to do, and it'll take 2 or 3 minutes for the meat to brown. I'm not going to go through the whole process. I'm giving you, the 2 or 3 minutes of this. I'm just giving you the general steps so you can follow them. And then when we have the, after we get the meat brown, we're going to simmer it. And we're going to use some red wine. This is mountain red wine, which I use both for drinking and for cooking. And here's a little leftover meat gravy. And then we'll have some consommé and some herbs like bay leaf and rosemary. And we'll have some garlic also. And so after your meat is browned nicely, you then want to put some flour on it and season it with some salt and pepper. So sprinkle a little salt on it and a little pepper. Then toss it again and then season it again. You'll find that if you put the seasoning on the meat first, it sort of cooks in. That's just salt and pepper. And then we're going to flour it. In French cooking, they usually brown the meat first and then add the flour afterwards because it gives it more flavor. And the amount of flour to add depends on how much sauce you want. It's about one tablespoon of flour per cup of sauce. So that's a heaping tablespoon, which is equivalent to 2 tablespoons, and then shake it around again. The idea of putting the flour on now while you're cooking the meat is to brown the flour, and that will also brown your sauce. And then put on your 3rd tablespoon and toss it around again. And then let this cook for 2 or 3 minutes until you note that the flour has very lightly browned. And then, after that is browned, that will be 2 or 3 minutes more, then you take the meat off and you add your liquids. And I might as well take a look and see how these onions and peppers are doing nicely. They're cooking slowly. They won't have time to brown the way they should, but you get the idea of what they're supposed to do. Now, take your floured and seasoned meat off the heat and add some red wine. I'm putting in about a cup or a cup and a half there. It doesn't really make too much difference how much you add. We're going to have some meat stock also, and then this meat goes right into the casserole. I'll put it in that way. And the reason that you put your red wine in now is so that you can deglaze any coagulated meat juices that have collected in your frying pan. And now the meat and the onions and peppers are together, so we now add other liquid. And I have this leftover meat gravy. This can be any kind of meat, pork or veal or beef, and it can be roast meat or a pot roast. It doesn't really make any difference. You can make the stew in the same way. And this little leftover lamb gravy will give it the lamb its lamb quality. And then another flavor thing that's useful to have on your shelf is Smithfield ham spread. As you know, quite a few French recipes always have a little bit of fresh, unsmoked bacon in, or just plain bacon. And the ham spread gives you that quality. And then I'm going to use some canned mushrooms later on, so I'll put in the mushroom juice. And we want just enough liquid here so that the meat will be barely covered. So I'm also going to put in canned beef bouillon. And this should come just barely to the top of the meat. And then you want some herbs. Here's some rosemary. Those long little things. I'm putting in about, say, almost a teaspoonful. And then for color, you can put in some tomato paste. And if you have tomato paste, that whole can won't last very long in the refrigerator. It turns rather black. And the thing to do is, as soon as you've opened it and used what you want, then take it all out and put it in a little glass jar, and you can then freeze it. And then you'll have tomato paste whenever you want. And we also have put in some bay leaf. There's about a good bit of bay leaf. And I think garlic is always nice. I've got a garlic. I wanted to show you two kinds of garlic presses. We have, there's this kind, and then there's the kind that's just a plain round end. And I think if you can find the one that has a longer size, you'll find that it's much easier to put the garlic in. If you use it in the round press, very often you can't get the garlic in. I'm putting in about two garlic cloves there. I don't know where I found this one. I haven't been able to find another one like it, unfortunately. And now, after you have all of that in, taste it. It's going to taste terrible now because you've got raw red wine. But you want to be sure that you've got enough salt in. So just take a little taste. It has enough salt in it. Tastes like absolutely nothing now. But this is you now want to simmer this meat for just about an hour. And even though the meat was tender, if it was roast meat, if you want to turn it into a real stew, you have to let it simmer in its seasoned liquid so that the meat will take on the quality and the tenderness that is a stew. So an hour or more you want to simmer it until the meat is tender when you press it with a fork. And then you'll really find that you have transformed your meat into something that's entirely different, and the simmer's covered very quietly. And now, if you want to have a vegetable garniture, you can use some canned carrots and mushrooms. And you'll find that the carrots are going to have much more flavor if you saute them first in a little bit of butter. Here I've got some butter. It just needs about a tablespoon. Again, I'm using a no-stick pan, which I think is extremely useful for doing these things like carrots, so they won't stick. And you can save the carrot juice and put it in soup. I wouldn't put too much of it in your stew because it might make the stew sweet, which wouldn't be a very pleasant taste. At least it would be an un-French taste. And get your butter melted and hot. It should be hot. You should wait till the butter foam stops foaming and the butter is almost browning, and then put the carrots in. These are really very useful. I think if you think of these canned things as base ingredients that you are really given to flavor up as nicely as you can, you find that you can do some lovely things with them. And then with the carrots, let them sauté probably 3 or 4 minutes until they have just begun to brown very lightly, and get this movement again of just shaking the pan around to turn the carrots. And then after they have very lightly browned, you can then add the mushrooms. And you'll find also, I think, with mushrooms that these preliminary sautés give them so much more flavor, you really wouldn't realize that they were canned. And then, if you wanted to serve these just as a vegetable garnish, or in any case, you would sprinkle them with a little salt and pepper, and if they're going to be a vegetable garnish separately, you could toss them with some chopped parsley and probably some chopped scallions. But as soon as they've taken on their flavor, they're then ready to go into the stew. And I have another stew here that has simmered for the requisite amount of time, and the meat is tender, so that then these carrots and onions can go in. And at this point, you can have done your stew ahead of time, baste them all with the sauce. There, this stew is now turned into a ragout. And it's all ready to serve. You can set it aside and reheat it later. And now the potatoes should be ready. I have another bunch of potatoes. And look at this big pot holder I have now. And these have been in the oven a good hour. And you want to be sure, because we're going to unmold them, you want to be sure that they have risen up and that they have browned nicely. Because if they haven't cooked quite enough, you found that if you try to unmold them, they'll collapse, and that's too bad. So take a little knife and look in at the edge. There's a slight separation there. And be sure that it has browned around the edge. And then take your little knife and go all around the edge to loosen it. And then take a buttered serving platter and turn it upside down. And if your potatoes have cooked enough, you may find if you've done them ahead of time, that'll take a little longer than an hour. And then just turn that upside down and this should unmold. And unmold it very carefully if you see that there's a slight sign of collapse, which there isn't in this case. Nope. See, that's nicely browned, so it shows it's ready. And then there's the paper on the top. You'll have to peel that off. And that's browned very nicely. If it hasn't browned, it browned as nicely as you want on the top. You can sprinkle it with a little bit of cheese and then set it right under the broiler. But that really is very attractive and drama and dramatic. And that's, I think, why you want to be sure and use a mold that's fairly high. And here is our ragout, our l'improviste, which can go all around. You could, of course, serve this tambour parmentier separately on this dish, on a dish, and then bring the ragout in its casserole. In this case, it might have been better because I'm not going to be able to get all the ragout around. But it looks very pretty anyway, I think. And then you can have a separate dish to put the rest of your ragout in. And then as soon as you're ready, serve it. You probably could keep it warm over hot water, but I think the thing to do is to serve it right away. And I think also the potatoes are best if they're served just as soon as they're done and browned. Because you want them they have a lovely, delicate qualities, you'll see. And that cheese and the cream and the little bit of a puff there makes a potato with a very tender, nice texture. And then the stew goes around, on. And there you are. And with this, you could serve a green salad and probably some French bread. And as for a wine, you can use exactly the same wine that you used in the cooking. This is a mountain red, put in a carafe, just so that it makes it look a little fancier. And that makes an extremely nice meal. I'm going to serve another portion of it so you can see how it looks. There. And this has an extremely good taste, and I think it makes a splendid dish because the tambour of potatoes is so handsome and the ragout smells so nice. I've really, at this point, forgotten that it was instant potatoes in yesterday's pot roast. It's really such fun to make up recipes because you feel sort of smart when you do it, particularly if it turns out well. So that's all for today on The French Chef. This is Julia Child. Bon appétit.